Namaste, everyone. Well, mark in history and why Hindus are not able to respond. Our presenter is great scholar, Professor Ji. He is Namaskar, Professor Mukherjee. He is an academician and a historian, and let me just complete the introduction. Yeah. So, Dr. Shorodindu Mukherjee, he did his PhD from Delhi University, where he taught for 41 years before he retired as head of the Department of History at Hansraj College. He is the author of many scholars. Most of them have very long titles, unfortunately. But this is typical scholars. So he has written books on the tragedy in the Chittagong Hill Tracts, 1947, and then on the peasant politics and British government, and Janmabhoomi and host of others. His latest book has the shortest title. It is CAA 2019, Some Thoughts. And he had been formerly a PDF scholar at the University of London, Charles Wallace Visiting Fellow, University of Hull. And he was former member of the Indian Council of Social Science Research and Honorary President, Center for Research on Indo-Bangla, of the Indian Council of Historical Research, for historical research. So the theme of this global Hindu conference is based on the three colors, the green, white, and red, which represent the three forces which are inimical to Hinduism or Sanatana Dharma. And although they have entered India sequentially, but they are all concurrently very active. And although it is not a watertight compartment, but we see that the green predominantly feeds off the Dalit sections, the white of the tribal Hindu belts across India, and the red, which is the topic of this conversation, it is deeply entrenched in the middle classes and the upper classes in India. The question is, how did this Marxist invasion begin? When did it get entrenched in our bureaucracy and our academia and in the print and electronic media? Who facilitated it? And then the second part of our topic of the title is why Hindus are not able to respond. So when I read this section, it brought to me the image of the takeover of Afghanistan by the ragtag army of Taliban, where there was apparently no resistance at all. Although in this context, it is a very sophisticated attack. It is not a ragtag army. So with these words, I request you, Shorodindu-da, to kindly take over the topic. And if there is time at the end, we will field questions.
Thank you so much, Kiranji. Can you hear me?
We can, yes, we can hear you.
Fine. So thank you. Namaskar to everyone. Thank you to Rajiv Varmaji for organizing this mega conference. And well, this is a very important theme. Actually, it's a serious problem for those who are interested, not only in the academic discipline of history, but a future of India also, or Hindu civilization as such. Now the title is This is Marxist abduction of Indian history. The two components, why Hindus are not able to respond. So the title can be broken up into two parts. Now, whether the Marxists have abducted or Hindus have abdicated, that's a very, very important question, and that may hold the key to the answer. Or it is a history writing in India is a victim of politics. Now, these are different themes altogether, and probably we need another lecture, seminar to discuss this issue threadbare. Now, second thing is, why are Hindus have not responded to this? So let's begin with this. I think Rajesh told me about 20, 30 minutes time. I'll try to finish. You have been listening to very learned talks from so many of our friends. Now, why history? The academic discipline history is such an important theme in India for many of us, because most of the Indians are not satisfied with the history that is taught or the way the historical issues are discussed. It has been the prerogative of the politicians for a long, long time. I don't know how one should begin. Is a long story, is a very disturbing story, is a depressing story. Now, whatever view we may be holding about the impact of the British rule in India, and you're all nationalists, you're not, no one, I think, fond of British. The point is that after 500, 600, 700, 800 years, depending on which part of India you're from, Islamic rule. Suppose you're talking of Sindh, then it goes back to 1200 years or so. Bengal, 700 years. Assam, little less. The British, despite everything, the way they conquered the Indian Empire, the way they exploited, the way they ruled, British had created a little cultural space for Indians. This space was not open for hundreds of years during Islamic rule. That's very important. And the Hindu intelligentsia, they took advantage of this small opening, beginning with Raja Ramon Roy. Again, Raja Ramon Roy, some of you may like it, some of you don't like it. Yet he wrote some very important things. He did certain very important things. Unfortunately, people also misinterpret him. Let's be very factual. Time is very short. So begin with Raja Ram Mohan Roy. To say about 1930s, 1940s, a little more than 100 years, is a time when Hindu creativity was at its zenith. And what is called Bengal Renaissance, call it Bengal Renaissance, call it Indian Renaissance, because it started in Bengal, fine. Bengal, it flourished very much, but very important contribution made by various presidencies, Bombay, Pune, Madras, and then subsequently every part of India, say Lahore, Allahabad or Patna, every part of India, lots of creative talent, they contribute immensely to literature, philosophy, art, historical writing, politics. Now our specific goal is historical writing and the mindset it creates. And beginning with the study of Vedas, Dharma Shastras. Even Ramon Roy wrote a lot of things on the Hindu scriptures, Upanishad. lot of new interpretations. There are immense number of scholars who wrote multiple editions, commented on Vedas, Dharma Shastra, Kane's, Mahamudaya Kane's classic study of Dharma Shastras from Pune. Then on our classics, Ramayana, Mahabharata, Tagore wrote fantastic things on Ramayana. You can't think of it. What kind of things he wrote on Ramayana. Marvelous. So this creativity. And one of the areas in which Hindus did exceedingly, say, good job was their study of Indian history. And Hindus wrote well. They knew the languages. These days, so-called experts, they don't know. You become professor of ancient Indian history, you don't know Sanskrit. That was not the thing those days. Even Raja Ramon Roy, the first major book, Tuhfatul Muhammadin, The Gift to Monotheist, he wrote in 1804 and 5. This was a book written in Arabic, an introduction to Persian. So he knew the subject, knew the language. And this was actually a severe criticism of monotheistic religions. Mind you, he has criticized Hinduism, Sanatan Dharma, that you are used to that. But he had criticized that also. So that was the beginning, say. And in course of next 100 years, and Hindus from every part, right from the Cholas, Vijayanagar, Bengal's history, or history of Gangetic Plain, Kakatiyas, Maharashtra, Sikh, every part of India, great creative minds wrote fearlessly, wrote competently. And British had allowed this much. Maybe I have mentioned this earlier. I'll again repeat. See, my father's generation, say 1930s, say 1920s, 30s. Height of British Empire. They went to Christian-run schools. So I'm talking of Bihar. You know what book they read in history? Who wrote that? Ramesh Chandra Dutt. Second batch of Indians to get into ICS. The first one was poet Tagore's Gurudev's elder brother. Second batch, three Bengalis, one from Maharashtra. Four Indians have got into civil service. ICS, the most prestigious civil service in the world, job in the world. Ramesh Chandra Dutt was an economic historian. He became president of Congress. Don't confuse that Congress with this Congress, huh? Please. So that was our main national movement, symbolic. He wrote a book of history of India. How did it begin? Mother and motherland, says the poet, are greater than heaven. This is our Janani Janma Bhumisha Swargat Vigariyasi. This was taught to Indian students in British times, beginning with this. Can you do this now? Are bah, communal Hindu, kya ho gaya, afad ho gaya. No one, this government also has not done. In fact, this government has not changed a single line of history books that was given to the Marxists. It's a different story. So point is, good scholars, said various parts of India, I said, they wrote, and some of them wrote exceedingly well. Shama Sastri, Bhandarkar's father and son. Tilak also wrote on that. Ranade wrote on that. And then, of course, Sir Jadunath Sarkar, Ramesh Chandra Mojumdar, Jaiswal Sahab, Altekar, all great, great minds. Now, this creativity gradually was stopped. Indian politics, Indian politicians stopped that. How does it begin? So this is where these two questions, Marxist abduction and whether Hindus have responded to or not, will try to combine this. This is when Khilafat movement started, as one of the previous speakers has mentioned. Khilafat, as you know, has nothing to do with Indian politics, Indian nationalism. The Turkish emperor, and in that process, massive anti-Hindu genocide was started in Kerala, Moplas. Moplas committed genocide of Hindus. Thousands of Hindus were killed, were abducted, converted. And this was done, Khilafat movement was done at the behest of Gandhi. Gandhi wanted to take the support of Muslims. Muslims are not joining national movement. So he thought he will get the support of Muslims if he can support the Khilafat movement. But it's a very disastrous thing. Disastrous thing. And then subsequently, Gandhi tried to rationalize that. Okay, that's not much. Okay, it's just some stray acts of lawlessness. But Hindus have suffered very, very seriously. Incidentally, I have written a foreword to a book written by Shankaran Nair in 1921. This book was, again, a new edition, came up last year. I have done the foreword to that. So there I have again explained these things. So Gandhi actually put a stop to Hindu reawakening. Hindus should not complain. And if who have attacked you happen to be Muslim, Islam, then better keep quiet. We need to unite, put up a united all India front to fight the British. Very, very wrong tactics, because Gandhi had rationalized anti-Hindu violence and thousands of Hindus were killed then. Then again, this is politics. So after that, gradually Congress adopted a policy that, okay, Hindus' grievances should be smothered. We should smother that. Hindus should not be encouraged. But others, Muslim grievances, Islamic, we must pamper. So this is how communalization, Muslim politics, Muslim communalist politics got encouragement from Indian National Congress. Then two more things happened. One was a book by Manavendranath Roy. He's a Bengali Brahmin revolutionary, famous revolutionary, who later became Lenin's right-hand man. Moscow, he had set up the first Communist Party outside Russia in Mexico. And earlier, he was a revolutionary. He fought the British, fled India, and then gradually becomes a communist. He wrote a book. This is a book. The Historical Role of Islam, 1939. This is a dangerous book, which is a glorification of Islamic conquest, Islamic imperialism. So again, it's trying to justify that Islam was a great thing. Why do blame Islam? Islam is so nice. It has done so many wonderful things. And then our Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru. He wrote Discovery of India, and where he had again rationalized the Islamic rule, anti-Hindu violence. It's a long story, book running into more than 400 pages. Just one thing, Babur, who invaded India, set up the Mughal Empire. How he describes Babur? The Renaissance prince, man of culture. Look, when this man of culture broke to pieces one of our sacred temples in Ayodhya, built a mosque over that. And you know what it meant? His demolition brought a new life into the life of Hinduism. It gave a big encouragement to Hindu national sentiment. So Gandhi's Khilafat, Moplas, M.N. Roy, Nehru. Broadly speaking, these three major developments Indian politics ensured that Hindu grievances should not be highlighted. इसको बिल्कुल जमीन में गाड़ दो. और those who are encouraging, those who are attacking, insulting, killing Hindus, they should be justified, they should be pampered. And Muslim League took advantage of that only to divide India. The ground had been prepared both by Congress, Gandhi and Jinnah. And the ground had been prepared for centuries, as you know. So this is one part of the story. After independence, Pandit Nehru appointed Maulana Abul Kalam Azad as India's first education minister. He was born in Mecca. He was actually an Ottoman Turkish citizen, subject. Then they migrated to India, settled in Calcutta. He was a Muslim theologian. He was earlier blatantly with the Islamic groups, radical Islamic groups. Then he joined Congress. But Congress also, his priority was that he always tried to see Indian politics in terms of whether it's good for Muslims or not. So he objected to partition because he said it is not good for the Muslims. He didn't say that it is damaging India as a civilization unity, how it causes harms to the Hindus. He didn't do that. And he didn't know modern education. But he was Nehru's choice. Nehru was trained at Cambridge, as Eaton earlier, who wrote good English, at least. His choice was Maulana Azad. And this is when the trouble started. The difference between Tarachand, who was a favorite Congress historian, R.C. Majumdar, Doyen of Indian Historians, about how you characterize 1857. Then R.C. Majumdar had to resign from the committee. So this is how, by early 50s, 1950s, by then Marxists had not come to power. They're not holding position. Nehru was a congressman. Maulana Azad was a congressman with strong pro-Muslim feelings. And communists had not come to power anywhere. They came to power in Kerala very late, 57, short-lived ministry. They had no influence on central government. Yet, to succeed in Indian politics, you have to do consistent anti-Hindu things because you need communal block vote. So this is the great contribution which Nehru made to Indian politics. This is in Nehru secularism. So you have a Hindu court bill marriage, but nothing on Muslims. Nothing could be done on that. So Kashmir should get special treatment, Article 370. No Indian could settle down. But no such special articles are applicable for any Indian state. And then where he allowed, both Gandhi and Nehru allowed Pakistan to mistreat, horrendous treatments of its Hindu, Sikh, Buddhist minorities. But here they had a secular state which would favor Muslims and go out of the way to harm Hindus. So this is the political background to the history that we have. Subsequently, when Mrs. Gandhi became Prime Minister, he appointed one Professor Nurul Hasan from Aligarh Muslim University as Minister of Education. And this is when the large-scale infiltration of Marxist historians took place. What is Marxist? Okay, if you have some economic explanation, it's fine. Economy is very important. So, to tell you a fact, when we studied, I had never any problem while teaching using books written by very top grade Marxist scholars of England. If you've done history, like Christopher Hill, Eric Hobsbawm, we had no problem. They had some bias, but on the whole, very good, serious work. In India, what Marxists did, they are mainly Hindus actually. Hindu family names, all parts of India, Hindu family names, but they're Marxist. They're members of Communist Party, or people realize that if you do well in India in social sciences, then you must get the Marxist tag. Though in the heart of hearts, they would be rabid casteist, they would be regionalist, and they will indulge in every dirty trick, but they will say we are Marxist, as if very fair, very big minds. They are not. So unlike the top grade British historians whose books I have used, and I still read those books, recommend those books, Indian Marxists, I don't want to name them and pollute this atmosphere, you know their names. 4, 5, 6 so-called big quote-unquote names, and then their disciples, they are still ruling actually. The books they gave in 2005 when the Congress government come back, the same books are still taught in Indian schools. Mind you, when Atalji's government fell, Congress government came to power. Immediately, the education minister of Congress, Arjun Singh, appointed a committee to review the textbooks. Earlier, some textbooks had been given by Atalji's government, but they had mounted a campaign, detoxify communal Hindus, things like that. So immediately, in 1 year's time, that committee gave a report and they scrapped all the books given by Atalji's government. So they gave a new set of history books in 2005. And now this is 2021. That is how many years? 15, 16 years after that, still those books are running. So the question is, Marxists have abducted or Hindus have abdicated? अरे क्या करना है हिस्ट्री से भाई, पॉलिटिकल पावर है, पैसा बना रहे हैं, हिस्ट्री क्या होता है छोड़ो. वेरी रॉन्ग, बिकॉज हिस्ट्री शेप्स द माइंड ऑफ पीपल. सेम थिंग हैपेंस इन एकेडमिक इंस्टीट्यूशंस, सिलेबस, एवरीवेयर सेम बुक्स आर रनिंग. देयर आर लॉट ऑफ इंटरेस्टिंग थिंग्स, वेरी डिप्रेसिंग थिंग्स. आई डोंट वांट टू टेल यू ऑल दीस थिंग्स, because this is a very depressing story actually. Yeah. Very depressing story, because there's no controversy when there's a physics book is introduced or economics book. Maximum controversy about historical writing, but everyone knows something about the history from your parents, grandparents, newspapers. You get some idea about certain things, and the children are taught at a very early stage, class 4 or 5 onwards, certain basic things, and that goes deep into the psyche, mind, and that stays there. You see, if I talk to you, how many people listen? 30, 40, 50, 100, 200 people? You give a textbook, Government of India textbook, it goes to crores of students all over India and the central school, Indian school, abroad also. And it is the foreigners will take up those schools. Okay, this is a book taught in India, so you also encourage the books. We don't have this advantage. So we are losing out. Who? Leave aside Hindu, Muslim, Christians, nothing, Indian. Authentic, true history of India. Just be honest. You just write objective, honest history.
Yes.
Lot of things can be changed. I'll just take 5 more minutes. So this is a problem. Marxist abducted, they were set up by a Congress government. Indira Gandhi, and earlier the ground had been set up by Nehru and Maulana Azad. with the main fault lines to the most controversial thing in Indian history, the Islamic rule of India, the most pathetic, tragic story. Centuries after centuries, Hindus were, temples were converted, mosques were built, they were converted by force, their women were abducted, and they were exported as labor, Central Asia, and Hindu kingdoms lost their independence. This is the most important story. You can still write a lot of things about how the British exploited. You can write, but you can't write so many things also, freedom movement. You can't write about the revolutionaries. You just know two or three names. You're told only about Gandhi, Nehru. Gandhiji fasted and British just fled India. My God. So he gives an absurd explanation. So politics is the country. Countries like India, politics is everything. Politics, those who have political power, they have education. So they decide. And most of the historians, they try to seek favor of the political masses. It is they who gave job. It is they who arrange funding. It is they who promote you. And if you do very well as a loyal supporter of government, you may become a governor, you may become ambassador also. So all kinds of things are there. So Hindus have not, generally speaking, most of the Hindus have not shown much interest. Whatever genuine, authentic history that we have is because of the great work done by the pre-independent scholars, Sir Jadunath, Sir Rameshchandra Majumdar, Bhandarkar Sahib, Jaiswal Sahib, I mean, big names. After independence, anyone who shows any objectivity, honesty, they'll be sidelined, finished off, careerized, finished off. So you can't write, you can't get funding, you can't write books. If you write books, your books would be reviewed and your books would not be included in the textbook. So how do you write? So Sitaram Goeltak people, Ram Sarupji, they will write book. And now because of internet, social media, people are reading those books. Yet that remains confined to a very small number, microscopic number. Unless it is, becomes part of the academic curriculum, it doesn't go beyond a point. So, aapas mein baat karenge, 50 people, 100 people, both acha, somebody said both acha, but fine. Young minds, children, they don't get a chance to absorb those ideas. With the result, we have developed a defeatist mind. Our people surrender, always blaming fate. Acha, destiny mein hi likha hai, toh hi hoga. So, this has to change. So I would not say Marxists are guilty. They have an agenda, and Marxists are just not Marxists. They are actually part of a larger conspiracy, anti-Hindu conspiracy. So Marxists in India are actually the warriors fighting for Islamic cause. So I always call them, on print also, I call them jihad-friendly secularism. So Nehru gave the concept of secularism, which is jihad friendly. Hindus should not protest. Hindus should not keep quiet. And so this is how the system has been going on for decades. 2021, I see no change. 8 years after this government came to power. So what is the way out? Now, this is for you to decide whether you want to assert your rights. You want genuine history. I want to know about my ancestors, my legitimate right. And politicians can't say, no, you should not do it because this doesn't suit my politics. We can't give them the power. We need authentic history. Sirf authentic history. Give us our right to speak facts. Don't ask us to tell lies to our children. Just permit us to speak the truth, no propaganda. And then Hindus can win the case. So all of us have to try. In the meantime, whoever is writing something authentically, keep discussing, keep talking. Beyond that, what you can do. Anyway.
Neeraj Atri.
I'll just finish. Thank you so much for giving this opportunity to talk to you. Hope you will all carry on the crusade, Dharma Yudh, chalayenge aap log, and insist, try that our government, our leaders, they see, they appreciate the honesty of purpose, because authentic history actually helps the nation to grow. Anyway, thank you so much. Namaskar.
Thank you, Professor Mukherjee. I think we need many more sessions because the topic is so vast.
Yeah, yes.
But the difficulty is there are two or three things. One thing is that if something is part of a school syllabus, the children have to internalize it because they have to pass the exam. And once it is internalized, it becomes part of the psychological makeup of the child. So it is so dangerous, you know. That is one thing. Secondly, Professor Mukherjee, you mentioned about these British historians, and also in passing you mentioned Jawaharlal Nehru's discovery of India.
Yeah.
So I had come across Dr. Kundan Singh's work on James Mill.
Yeah.
Where he has spent 20 years studying James Mill's History of British India, which was published in 1818, 200 years ago. And some people have found that Jawaharlal Nehru's Discovery of India has regurgitated passages from that book. So he never came to India. His academic discipline was theology. He had studied in divinity. He could not become a priest. So by default, he became a journalist and then a historian. And this book became a standard curriculum for those who come to India as part of East India Service, I mean, company and ICS. So he mentions that this was also taken up by Marx via Hegel. And the theme in that is hierarchical suppression, that in all ways, Hindus means hierarchy and oppression. And that is how Marx's works, wherein refers to India, is derived from this 200-year-old three-volume work on the history of British India.
So, thank you.
Is there anybody who would... Yes, sir. You were saying something.
I mean, such a mischievous thing in the sense... All societies are hierarchical. All societies, whether it's Japan or England itself, is the House of Lords even now. Yes. And all societies, there have been kings, kulaks, big landlords, exploitation. So nothing about this in India. Yeah.
At the time when this book was written, 200 years ago, England was a monarchy. It was not a egalitarian society. So it is like I think there's a question from Arunam Bhattacharya. He says, one problem about schools and universities is the tight control from CBSC. Do you think more decentralized schools, colleges and universities will help break this Marxist stranglehold on history textbooks?
You see, the Marxists are not controlling government of India.
Yeah.
How many Marxist governments are in India now? Yes. Tell me.
Yeah.
Kerala has a communist government. Rest, they are not there. And central government, which runs most of the universities in India, most of the central schools, NCERT, controlled by the BJP government.
There is no justification.
Not there. It's for them too. So Marxists don't blame. Even if they do, I have fought against Marxists all my life. A campaign.
We know.
Whatever I write in response to that only. Ram Janmabhoomi, refugee problem, peasants, even everything against them.
Yes.
But the point is, that is their agenda. Why should you grasp them? If Muslim League has an agenda, that is their agenda. You allowed them to do. We should have our own agenda. Pursue it. No one has stopped us. No one has stopped us from doing that. We don't have an agenda on academic matters. That is it. So they take advantage. So
the general
join the meeting.
Yeah.
Are we out of time?
Must be a lot of
Okay. I think the general view is that 70 years of Nehruvian rule forced the BJP to come to power. But then we are not getting the benefit that we expected in terms of assertion of our identity.
There are so many developments which is not worth talking about. Now, just to end, just you have 2 minutes time?
Yes, sir. Please go ahead, sir.
Interesting, you should know this. The oldest academic or research institution in India is the Asiatic Society in Calcutta. Asiatic Society?
Asiatic.
By Warren Hastings in 1784. If you go to Calcutta, just visit that. Fantastic. Well, 1784. And lots of important researches have been done in British time. Lots of good work, journals. Now, this is controlled by Ministry of Culture in New Delhi. Government of India. Central government. Totally controlled finance, discipline, administration. Now, they have brought out a book last year, Comprehensive History of Bengal, in 3 volumes, huge volumes, edited by a so-called, famous historian, Sabyasachi Bhattacharya. Sorry, he's dead. He was the chairman of ICHR. He was the vice chancellor. He's written lots of interesting books, but basically he belonged to that camp. 3 volumes, huge volumes, more than 3,000 pages. Maybe more than 50, 60 scholars, if not more, writing on that. Or surprised, even foreign historians, Bangladesh historians have been invited to contribute to that. And they are spreading their views. Aryans came from outside, upper caste Hindus, Hindus from the partition of India. And then this is line in India also. So they get a chance to criticize again Hindu society, India. Even when this is controlled totally by central government. So how does it happen? These are not very pleasant things to ask. So why do you blame Marxists have done this? You bhi kijiye na, Marxists hai nahi na. Aap control kar rahi ho, you control purse strings, you control the administration. You if you want, you can do it. If you don't want, then don't blame them. They have an agenda. You have an agenda. If you don't have any agenda, blame them. Why don't you ask them why they are doing it? Why you're not doing it? That means either you're not interested or for you it is not that important. It's a low priority. I can't answer these things, but I am just reading those books now. I was horrified. I just got hold of this book a few days back. It was horrible. So our government is encouraging Bangladeshi scholars, blatantly anti-Hindu scholars to come. Eat out of hands. Our government is paying them airfare to come, hold workshops, get the money and write at our cost. So Indian taxpayers' money, they are enjoying and they are spreading Kannada against India, against Hindu society. And we say, Marxists are abducted. So I said, whether Marxists are abducted or we are abdicated. We are in power, so let's enjoy political power. So if this attitude, what can we do? Anyway. Long story.
So, thank you so much, sir. It is such a delight to listen directly from a great scholar and a great nationalist yourself.
I'm sorry, it's a depressing story. See, probably you know all this.
Yes, but do we have time to take one question, Richaji?
Yes.
I don't know.
Yes, Giranjit, definitely. I think Amit Sharma has a question.
Amit Sharma has a question. Please, Amit, can you unmute yourself? Amit? Yeah, please unmute yourself and ask the question. Please unmute yourself.
Unable to mute. Not able to mute.
No, you can ask.
Ask your question quickly because we are already over time.
Okay. Thank you. Sir, it is possible I can ask a question in Hindi because we are lots of Indian people listening. Yeah,
please ask in Hindi.
जी मैं ये पूछना चाह रहा था कि इतनी बुक्स को लिखा गया और इतने बालकों को पढ़ाया गया जो आज करोड़ों के अंदर बैठे हैं, what communist want exactly? Even they cannot handle two countries, big countries. दो बड़ी countries communist के पास में थी, China.
आपका question बहुत अच्छा है. Let me give it to Sarandeep जी. जी, thank you.
भारत में क्या करेंगे? Even
we need to have an answer from you, Professor.
देखिए कम्युनिस्ट का काम होता है डिस्ट्रॉय करना, डिस्ट्रक्टिव है कम्युनिस्ट. रशिया में जो भी पहले पहले लेनिन ने कुछ किया था, कुछ तरक्की किया था, इंडस्ट्री लगाया था, एडुकेशन किया था, ठीक बात है, लेकिन ज्यादा इनके सोसाइटी वायलेंस पर चलता है. और इंडिया में कम्युनिस्ट लोग बिल्कुल डिस्ट्रक्टिव रहे हैं, टोटली एंटी नेशनल, एंटी हिंदू, और जहां भी रहते हैं यूएस में काफी चल रहे हैं, इन लोग काफी आजकल बढ़ रहे हैं, इनको डिस्ट्रॉय करना चाहते हैं. कोई कंस्ट्रक्टिव एजेंडा इनका है ही नहीं. बंगाल को रूल किया, सारा बर्बाद कर दिया टोटली. इनके पास कुछ क्रिएटिव कुछ एबिलिटी होता ही नहीं है. हल्ला करना चाहते हैं, शोरगोल करना चाहते हैं, डिस्ट्रक्टिव बेसिकली है. इज ए गैंग्रीन फॉर एनी सोसाइटी. कम्युनिस्ट आर ए बिग मिनस. ये खत्म हो जाए, जो भी है इनका इन्फ्लुएंस खत्म हो जाए तो बहुत अच्छा होगा. सब कोशिश कीजिए इनको हटाया जाए. ये बैठे हुए सब जगह एकेडमिक में, मीडिया में बैठे हुए हैं और समझते हैं कि हम बहुत बड़े बुद्धिमान हैं. बहुत बुद्धि भ्रष्ट लोग हैं, ये भयंकर लोग हैं. तो इनको हटाना बहुत मुश्किल है नहीं, लेकिन करना चाहिए ना. करने के लिए इच्छा चाहिए आपको, वो इच्छा होनी चाहिए.
थैंक यू प्रोफेसर सौरदिंदु जी, धन्यवाद. हमारा समय समाप्त हो गया है तो ऋचा जी आप शुरू कर सकते हैं.
थैंक यू सो मच प्रोफेसर, एंड थैंक यू किरण जी फॉर मॉडरेटिंग. आई थिंक इट वाज अ फैंटास्टिक सेशन. बहुत ही अच्छे से आपने समझाया. इट वाज रियली गुड. यू नो दैट्स इट्स द रियलिटी ऑफ लाइफ एंड यू नो द सॉर्ट ऑफ सिचुएशन दैट एग्जिस्ट इन एकेडेमिया. Unfortunately, we don't have time for questions. Devesh ji and Anand ji, if you want to write, all of you, anyone who wants to write their questions, it'll be easier for us to moderate and ask the questions. So please do that. But Sarandeep ji, I will, you know, thank you so much. And I think hum log ek 10-minute ka break lenge beech mein, so people can sort of catch up on their breakfast ya jo bhi hai, dinner in India. And then we will start with the next session.
Thank you.
Very good. Thank you so much. Thank you. Namaskar. Thank you so much.
Namaskar. So one of the questions, Professor Mukherjee, is can you share a few links and topics that we should know more and